March 10, 1983. Elisabeth Mühlinghaus still feels cheerful as the first contraction kicks in. Her husband drives her to the hospital that evening. The 31-year-old eats a bread roll in front of the delivery room. 2 hours later, her baby is born. Tender skin, tiny fingers. Everything was just as it should be, the doctors promised. A girl so small and perfect. Her name was Tanya. Only 15 years later, Tanya would leave her home without ever coming back. Let's get into her story. Tanya Mühlinghaus was born on March 10, 1983 in Wuppertal, northwest of Germany. Wuppertal is known for its steep slopes, its woods and parks, and its suspension railway, the Wuppertal-Schwebebahn. It is the greenest city in Germany with 2/3 green space of the total municipal area. From any part of the city, it is only a 10-minute walk to one of the many public parks or woodland paths, so it's a very serene place to live. Tanya herself was an only child. She had brown hair and hazel eyes, and she grew up to be a very beautiful young lady. I mean, she was stunning. However, as is often the case during puberty, Tanya wasn't the easiest child growing up. She would oftentimes rebel against her parents, craving more freedom and independency. And she felt that her parents were too strict with her. We've all been there. On October the 21st, 1998, nothing appeared to be out of the norm. Tanya, now 15 years old, left her family home to attend the Karl Duisberg Gymnasium, a grammar school. At this time in her life, Tanya really enjoyed dancing, and she even attended dance lessons at school. Tanya also loved to collect small perfume bottles, which she kept locked up in a cabinet, together with a few souvenirs from her many travels. That was one of her many passions. She had also just met her very first boyfriend, a boy named Mario. The two had actually agreed to meet up in the coming days, and they were generally very happy together. I mean, it was a new young love. That morning, Tanya left for school a little bit later, as her first class began at 10 a.m. that day. Her mother was already at work at this point, and Tanya had called her to ask to be picked up from school, to which her mom agreed. This is something Tanya would often do, and her mom would always pick her up after school. When it was time to pick Tanya up, Elisabeth, as promised, parked up by the school, but her daughter never came. After waiting a while, her mother eventually left, probably thinking Tanya met up with a friend or went home instead. But when she arrived at home, a classmate of her daughter's called the family's home phone. And strangely, she asked her mom how Tanya was feeling, seeing as she hadn't come into school that day. Her mom was then slightly worried. Despite being rebellious, it wasn't very typical for Tanya to not attend school. She would always go to school, and she would always show up whenever she was being picked up. She was quite reliable when it mattered. At 9:15 p.m., Elisabeth then called the police, but they assured her that this is typical teenage behavior and that her daughter would get back when she satisfied her need for adventure. The next day, as her parents go to check their daily post, they see a letter, seemingly from Tanya, in the letterbox. The letter, which was not dated, read, "Dear Mom, Dear Dad, please don't worry about me. I am well and I will be home in 2 to 3 weeks, so you don't have to look for me. Please take care of my rabbits and the babysitting. Please make use of the things that I have ordered. Come up with something to say to the school. I need a bit of space and I will be in touch again next week. Your Tanya." The letter was marked with X1, which probably translates to it being the first letter. When this letter arrived, Tanya's mother was first very relieved to see what was obviously her daughter's handwriting. She was just happy that her daughter was still alive. However, when she actually read the letter, she got this gut feeling that something was off. And she felt that way because the way the sentences were structured wasn't Tanya's writing style at all. The letter featured very short, straightforward, emotionless sentences. It just felt rushed, not written in a way Elizabeth knew her daughter would write, had she really not wanted her mother to worry. But she didn't have long to ponder this because only 4 days later, on October the 26th, a second letter arrived. The letter was dated October the 24th and read, "Dear Mom, Dear Dad, you still don't have to worry about me. I am doing well and I will actually get back the next weekend already. That's why you don't have to look for me. I hope you will do the things I asked you to do for me in the last letter. Your Tanya." This letter was marked X2, indicating it is the second letter sent. Her mother, despite her persistent gut feeling, still felt happy. Her daughter was coming home. She then quickly called her husband to tell him that Tanya was coming back earlier than planned. The weekend came, and Elizabeth sat in her house waiting for her daughter to return. She stared at the door for hours on end, but Tanya never showed. And from this moment onwards, Elizabeth would never hear from her daughter again. Both letters would be examined by the state criminal police office. They too confirmed that it is very likely Tanya's own handwriting in the letters. They also confirmed that it was Tanya who either licked or taped the envelopes shut. I assume they had her DNA to prove this. Additionally, they found that both letters had been stamped at the Düsseldorf Mail Center, some 40 minutes from Wuppertal. Düsseldorf is a far larger city with twice the population of Wuppertal, so locating Tanya would be no small feat. During the early investigation, which began on November the 2nd, flyers were hung up, interviews were given, and Tanya's case was covered on Aktenzeichen XY. At first, without any significant result. That is until authorities spoke to a man named Patrick Oat, who gave them a 74-page statement. And something in that statement convinced Elizabeth that he did indeed meet Tanya. She came to this conclusion because some of the stuff that he had mentioned had never been made public. So Patrick said that he met Tanya in 1999, when both of them were working as illegal door-to-door sales employees. In the Germany of that year, salesmen would usually sell newspapers, and it was illegal because in order to sell those, you'd have to register as a company and pay tax, which they did not. Anyway, according to Patrick, their manager had for unknown reasons shot Tanya, leaving all her clothes covered in blood. But from what Patrick could see, she was still alive at this point. The apparent dispute took place on a small plot of land in a forest. Police of course went there straight away, with a few tracking dogs as well. But by the time they got there, there was no sign of Tanya. A few years after his initial chat with the police, Patrick then called Tanya's mother and told her that he shares a daughter with Tanya, called Janine. He also said that he was in touch with Tanya and that the two lived in Frankfurt am Main, some 3 hours from Wuppertal. However, back then he was actually in prison for causing bodily harm and fraud. Elizabeth then went to visit him in prison, and she was allowed to have a long conversation with him. Said conversation was filmed and turned into a documentary. In it, Patrick comes across as a charming man. He appears almost believable, just a normal guy. So Patrick basically relives his past with Tanya, all the places they had met, how they eventually ended up together, and everything in between. He actually stated that they dated from 1999 until 2001. He also claimed that while working that illegal sales job, Tanya was provided with new identity documents, totally illegal of course. Either way, this allowed the then 15-year-old to vanish into thin air, assuming the identity of a made-up 20-year-old called Melanie. Patrick then promised Elisabeth that he will try and convince Tanya to get back in touch with her mother. Elisabeth said that she is not angry with her daughter and to please tell her that. Sadly, her mother said that she herself feels like she has failed her daughter as a parent, which of course is not true. After this talk with Patrick, Elisabeth left and the two decided to stay in touch. A short while later, he then reached out to Elisabeth via Facebook, and he sent her a message seemingly from Janine, Tanya's daughter. Elisabeth was of course both relieved and happy. She took this as a positive sign despite the fact that she didn't really know if Janine is at all related to her. According to the documentary, Patrick organized a meeting between Tanya and Elisabeth. Everything was ready, the date was set, the time agreed on. She was to meet her daughter at a train station in 2017. Elisabeth was understandably over the moon. 19 years of waiting, hoping. 19 years of fearing the worst, and now she was going to see her child again. Just imagine. But when the day came, Elisabeth received a message from Tanya telling her that she couldn't do it, she just couldn't meet her. According to what was said in the message, Tanya didn't want her old life back, and she wasn't ready to face all of that again. She had moved on, and by the sounds of it, she preferred her new life. But Elisabeth never heard from either one of them again. Patrick even deleted her off of his Facebook. Side note, when looking at Patrick's Facebook profile, there is no Janine or Melanie to be found, not in his friends list or even as a like on one of his pictures. So we don't know whether his profile is actually real or whether he was telling the truth at all. Authorities have also never revealed whether they have looked into his newest claims. So what happened to Tanya? Was she forced to write those letters? Was someone dictating what she should write? Is that why the sentences were so short? Was there someone who forced her to work as a lady of the night? Countless witnesses have indeed called in, particularly from Cologne, 1 hour away from Tanya's hometown, to claim they had seen her work in the late night district. But no lead has led anywhere so far. And speaking of leads, police have but a handful. 3 years following Tanya's disappearance, her parents parted ways. Each kept a part of Tanya's old bedroom. Her father kept his daughter's old wardrobe and bed, while her mother kept her old type case. They are hoping that Tanya will be found alive and well to this day. And the investigation is technically still ongoing. And that is sadly all there is to this case. Thank you very much for listening, and see you next week. Bye, Gators.